is here for a reason, and I know that we're going to just worship as a family and worship all together. God, that you just be with our speaker as they're going to give the word tonight. You give them the comfort and the peace, and that your anointing just falls over us right now, Father. We just want to just feel you tonight. We thank you for everything, and in Jesus' name, amen. The power of sin and darkness, whose love is mighty, it's so much stronger. The King of glory, the King above all kings, who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder, who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is amazing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You would lay down your life. That I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I see you for all that you did for me. Together. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. I see you for all that you did for me. Come on, let's sing the chorus together. This is amazing grace. This is a unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You would lay down your Jesus, I seek for all that you did for me. The splendor of the King, clothed in majesty, let all the earth rejoice, all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light, darkness tries to hide, and trembles at his voice. Trembles at his voice. How great is our God. See with me how great is our God. And all will see how great. How great is our God. Church, y'all sing it. How great. How
great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God. And all will see how great. How great is our God.
Come to the water, all who are thirsty. come to the table, all who are hungry. Come and feast those who are weary, those who are needy. Come receive. Come to the river. Come to the river. Taste and see. Come to the river. Come to the river. Taste and so You may be seated.
So I'm preaching tonight? No, I'm joking. No, Albert is taking a vacation day. So he had asked Chris Ramos. He told me to say that he had been watching Chris Ramos for a long time, and he's been watching his growth and stuff. And so he wanted to give him a chance to talk about himself and to throw a little word in there. And so y'all are lucky y'all didn't have me because, yeah. Anyway, so we want to bring up Chris Ramos. Give him a hand. Thank you.
Good evening, everybody. Y'all hear me? Okay, how y'all doing? As you could, Lori said, you could tell I'm not Albert. So, but he reached out to me and he pulled me aside Sunday and asked me if I could step in and give a little bit of inspiration, because walking alongside him has inspired him. He's inspired me. He's like a brother to me now. He's like a father figure. And so I started thinking, and as I just got to thinking about it, I started praying about it. Thank you, Jerry, for, you know, checking on me. I appreciate that. And immediately what came to my mind was God's timing and his confirmation. When I first got here, I've been at Calvary. January 8, 2017 was my first Sunday here. That changed my life. I always tell Albert, you know, I look for signs. I would always, growing up, tell God, I would ask God for signs, you know, show me a sign, show me a sign. But now I know that it's not about signs. It's about the confirmation that God is in your life, that you're doing the way, you're living the right way, you're doing the right things. And in thinking that, I sat back and I was wondering, you know, made me think, what we do here, what are we here for, and that why are we here? Sorry, I'm going to be doing a little reading, because like I said, it was from Sunday, so I'm just, sorry. We good? All right. I have a lot of notes here. And are we here to just sit here and give God thanks? Are we here because we found a place to do those works, as we say? To strengthen or to renew our faith. For me, it was all of those things, actually. All of those and a whole lot more. I love the song selection CC had, because it was, when I found Calvary, I found my river. You know, I found what I wanted to taste. I found what I wanted, where I wanted to drink from. I realized that God was that great power, that great leader, that great father. And his grace is that amazing. So, in looking for those signs, one of the big things was growing up, I always asked God for favors. Well, he was just a favor answerer. He wasn't my savior yet. But I can remember as far back as in high school, seeing a friend of mine fall out from an epileptic attack, and immediately I got to praying. Not really knowing, I grew up in a Catholic church until I was about 12, 13 years old, and it was just routine. You know, I went because my grandmother told me to. You know, if I didn't go, her friend that gave us a ride got me by the ear and put me in the car and took me anyway. So I saw my friend fall out, and I just immediately remember starting praying to God, God, save my friend. Don't let nothing happen to him. I can remember praying to God for my grandparents, who had a big hand in raising me, to just let my grandmother live long enough to see me graduate high school. I learned then, you be real specific on how and what you pray for. So for a long time, it was, you know, call it God's time. You know, like I said, it's God's timing. It wasn't anything I did, but little thereafter, a year after my graduation, she really started showing signs of dementia. We ended up losing her. She ended up living for about 10 more years. But for those 10 years, I blamed myself. Like, I should have just asked for more time. If God gave me that, he would have gave me a whole lot more. but he was the one who answered prayers, right? That's what he does. So, you know, so until, like I said, blaming myself, I was like, wait a minute. You know, you did answer it, but it wasn't the way I wanted it. But I guess I was too hung up on blaming myself. Sorry. So all through my youth, I used to tell everybody, I'm a grown man. I'm a grown man. I'll say but. My butt's grown, but I didn't use butt. You know, I used the other word for my butt. I thought I could make all my own decisions, you know, do life the way I wanted to do it. And then I found out I was wrong. I found out about 25 years later, I was wrong. I couldn't do it my way. I couldn't do it the way I wanted it to. I couldn't make the decisions I wanted to make. I had to lean on, as we hear a lot here, Proverbs 3:5, you know, I had to take away my understanding of what I thought life was and know that God was in control. So during those grown-up years of my youth, first off, let me just say, I wanted to come up here and, you know, everybody sees me. I mean, if you see me, I'm back in the soundboard. I'm in the sound booth. I felt a little guilty, Albert asking me to come up here and talk and, you know, give some of the word, because I was like, well, I go to church with so many great individuals, all these people that, to me at least, inspire me, whether y'all know it or not, inspire me to dig deeper, connect more, and find out who God is in my life even more so. I tell the guys all the time on Tuesdays, it's my favorite day of the week. I thank y'all a lot for those Tuesday mornings and evenings now. But I'm in my youth, doing it my own way. Oh, like I was saying, I'm sorry. I didn't want to come up here and give you guys the word out of the word without y'all knowing a little bit more about me. That's what I'm doing tonight. So I just wanted y'all to touch. I wanted to touch base and kind of give my testimony as to how I ended up here at Calvary Chapel. But so through my youth, I did it all. I mean, I broke a lot of laws and a lot of rules and did a lot of partying, and you could be addicted to it, I probably was. You know, I did my fair share of all kinds of stuff. You know, I had, at a young age, I was married at 21, didn't work out, that ended up divorced, got engaged again, that didn't work out, had a child from it, that shaggy-haired kid back there in the booth, King. But as I lived through these days and these years, I didn't know how much I needed God. I didn't understand it. It was just things weren't going my way. Okay, here we go again. It's the cycle all over again. But we all get caught up in that cycle. We all think you got it figured out. You think that you were going to do it the right way, you made all the right decisions, and then there you go again. At least I can speak to that. You fall flat on your face. So one night, my first real encounter with God, I was having a heated discussion, we'll say, with my son's other parent, and I became enraged. I was pretty angry at some of the things that she was saying and some of the things that she didn't allow me to do. And I was sitting there in my house getting angrier and angrier. And I thought to myself, I'm going to go over there. But I acknowledged to the fact that I knew if I went over there, I didn't know what was going to happen. I knew I was mad. I knew I was disgusted. I knew I was angry, but something had to happen. And I also knew at that moment, I'd never felt like this before. I've never been this angry before. So in pacing back and forth, I look up, and the only thing I could think to do was ask God, like, Lord, you need to please take this away from me. Take this out of me. Take this feeling from me. Because if I leave this house, I don't know if I can be held accountable for what I'm going to do. Because I don't know what's going to happen. I went outside, and only going back in because I forgot my keys to my truck. I go back in my bedroom, and I fall down to my knees, bawling my eyes out. I'd never cried like this before, but I'm sitting there crying and just begging God, whatever this is, take it out of me. So it felt like a moment, but it felt like an eternity. So I laid down and I had the greatest nap of my life. And I wake up, it's 4 o'clock in the morning, and I feel this just peace over me. I look up and I just said, thank you, God. Thank you. And I went back to bed and stayed out of trouble. So, as I continue on and trying to live my life, I started playing. And this is what bothered me the most for a while was, again, growing up in the Catholic Church, at least there was some kind of structure. I knew what Sundays were. But then getting older and stepping away from that, I like tried to do it my own way, did it myself. I never really allowed God back in my life. And that happens that night, and I realize he saved me that day. He showed me his favor. So I started sprinkling in church with my mother. That was our connection. And still not completely, I guess you'd say, faithful and going every Sunday. But I would go semi-regularly. And it made me feel better, you know, because some people, I was at that point where church was my Band-Aid. You know, you go, you feel good for a little bit, and then you keep going about your days and your weeks and your months, and then you go back to church when you feel like you need another Band-Aid or you need some medicine. So then I'm living at this point, like I said, one failed marriage, one failed engagement. I find myself living in the back room of my dad's house with my son. And I get a random text on a random Sunday morning that I usually just sleep in because Sundays were my only day of the week off. I get a random text from my cousin Renee, who comes to church here. Her and David usually sit over here somewhere. And she just out the blue texts me, says, you know, you're more than welcome to come to church anytime you want to with us. They'd been coming here for about 6 months, I believe. And I'm never up that early in the morning on Sundays at that time. So I looked at my phone and I was like, okay, that's kind of random. And I put it down. And me being me, I'm big on social media and, you know, keeping up with the news and keeping up with, you know, everything going on in the world. So I go back to my phone and I'm playing on social media. But you start to see those little memes and those little pages that are scripture worthy and, you know, verses and things like that, which, again, that really wasn't my life, so I don't really know where that came from. And I put my phone away. Then I started thinking again. I was like, wait a minute. So I reached back out to my phone, and I tell Renee, I was like, what time does church start? She said, it's 10:30 sharp. I said, okay. So I go back, lay down, still laying down, and go back to my phone, and there they are again. So I look up at the ceiling, and I said, okay, God, now I'm listening, and now I hear you. I text Renee back, and I said, okay, meet you there at church. Like I said, that was January 8, 2017, and I showed up, and there was nothing but hugs and handshakes and smiles and love and family here. And that was huge. growing up in a divorced home that was, I like to say my divorced home was divorced because I grew up with my father, but then again, I grew up with my grandparents because they lived with us too. My father was in and out and gone a lot and working a lot, so they raised me. So I never really had either one of my parents. Here in my later life, I've gotten a little closer to both of them, and I appreciate both of them for what they've done, whether they had an immediate effect on it or I learned from them in how not to do things. So I get that text, and now I'm coming to church. Excuse me. I'm going to pull something up. There we are. To know me is to know I'm also a very loyal person. I've been loyal to the company I work for almost 20 years now. And let's see, we're 2020. One day, I'll tell you a story. So that was a story of the night I went to sleep. That was my really big moment with God. And then the confirmation I had that really set it in stone for me for the rest of my life, because it was just one of those jaw-dropping for me moments that it was only God that did it. So one day, like if you know me, you know I work Geek Squad delivery. I deliver appliances and TVs. I work out in the heat. I work out in the sun. And, you know, I'll be in your house hooking up your appliances. We're throwing away the trash one day in the back of my box truck. We're in the back of the store. And me and my partner are tossing all of our cardboard and styrofoam away. And I noticed that our dumpster is filled with personal belongings. It looked like somebody took their car and just dumped it in the trash can. There was laptop bags. There was bunches of paper. There was bags of clothes, all kinds of things. And me and my buddy are just like, kind of like, wow, what happened here? Until I really see one thing that sticks out above all of them. Because I had my grandmother, my mother's mother, she was a very devout Christian. Her Bible. So what we see is a Bible in there. It was in one of those, I don't know if anybody here has that type, that it's like a carrying little satchel. You know, it's a leather bound, has a handle. I see that, and I knew immediately what it was. And I knew at that moment, this is the wrong place for that. So I grabbed that Bible. This is, let's see, we're 2020. This is 2008. I grabbed that Bible and put it in my overhead compartment in my delivery truck. From 2008, fast forward to 2018. In between there, I have three or four partners, three or four trucks, because we max out at so many mileage and we got to turn them in and get a new one. Three or four trucks later, I'm still having that Bible, and it's just up there. It's like I said, God has always been somebody around me, not really a focus for me. But I knew, at least if I have this Bible here, there's something about this Bible that's going to keep me. Never opening it, never reading it. It was really just a paperweight for our daily route. We knew at the end of the day, we'd stick our little papers right there. Funny thing was, is we never stuck it under the Bible. We always put it on top. And 10 years go by, and one day, like I said, it's 2018, I'm already at Calvary for about a year's time, and we're back at the dumpster, throwing trash away, and out of nowhere, the papers fall down on me. It's funny, it's like a little sitcom scene, just out of nowhere, they pour off over me, and it made me think, you know, I've never looked at this Bible ever, I've never opened it. So as my partner is throwing trash away, I'm thumbing through the Bible and reading and looking at every single page that has highlights and notes and letters to family and underlining and stories. This man, I was blown away how much this book must have meant to this gentleman. And I realized, this guy needs this book back. I say that, you know, and God rest her soul, I just lost my aunt a few months ago. She asked me one time back when I was, like I said, in the world and doing it my way. She asked me once, she said, "You ever read the Bible?" And I really offended her when I said, "You know, I've thumbed through it. It's a pretty good book." You know, kind of just putting it at that just basis of what it was. And she was like, "Oh my gosh, why? How could you say that?" She said, "If you really get into it, you'll realize what it'll do for you." So I'm thumbing through this Bible that day at work in the back of our store, and it hits me. I need to find out who this belongs to. I need to find out who this is, and I need to get them their book back. So every Bible has a little dedication page. If you give it as a gift, you know, you fill it out, who it's to, where it's from. And then it has that other page where this one, like, they marked when they were married, when they had their kids. Like, I knew this person's whole life in two pages. And so I, again, me being that social media guy, I go to Facebook and I start searching names. I strike out a couple times, and then I have a hit on the lady whose husband it belonged to. And I reached out to her, and just on a whim, because it matched the names, it matched the hometown she was from. And I asked her, I said, "You don't know me, and this is going to sound real crazy, but if you were married to Mr. So-and-so," I'll leave the names out, you know, but hopefully they're watching. I said, "I think I have something that belongs to you, and I don't know if you want it back." The next night, I get a message, I get a text message from her daughter saying, "You reached out to my mother, I'm her daughter, and yes, I believe that Bible belonged to my father. He's since passed. He died last year of Alzheimer's," which I could relate with because I lost my grandmother to Alzheimer's, so I was already like, okay, there's a little bit of connection going on here. And she said, "I'll put you in touch with my brother, and he would love to meet up with you. He would love to have our father's Bible back." So a couple of days go by, and he calls me. And we planned to meet one day after work. And I said, "Well, I'm kind of busy. They have us here, have us there." He's like, "Well, I'm not free until this weekend." So we planned to meet up after I got off of work and he got off work that Saturday. And I get off of work and I rush. And we're like scrambling, trying to figure out, what are we going to do? Where are we going to meet? He said, "Let's just go to Chick-fil-A." So we meet at Chick-fil-A. And we sit there and I'm telling him the story about how I've had this Bible. I found it in the dumpster 10 years ago. It's seen me through, you know, all of my work. I've kept it through four trucks, so many partners, and I've just held on to it knowing that I needed to. He says, "Well, I appreciate it." So out of nowhere, I get a tap on the shoulder, and it's my cousin Matt, who of all of my family, my generation, he's probably one of the most devout Christians that I know. And of all people to run into a Chick-fil-A, and if you all know Chick-fil-A story, you know they're a very well, you know, Christian-based organization. So it was just stars aligning, I guess you could say. And so I'm telling Matt why we're there. And he says, wait. He goes, "So," he looks at me, he says, "You're here for him and his father. He goes, "And what's your name, sir?" And he goes, the guy's name was Chris, and I'm Chris. The guy's father was named Chris. He goes, "So Chris, the father, has a Bible whose Chris, the son, is coming to collect from Chris, the man whose spirit was touched by this Bible. Do you see the line?" He goes, "The Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit. This is, God is here right now." Yeah, and I wasn't putting it all together until Matt said that. And we all just prayed right there. And he was like thanking me. He was like, "I don't know what to do." He goes, "But here's where it all comes together." He said, "I can't thank you enough." He said, "Because you finding it, you keeping it, and you holding on to it and reaching out to it until this week, whatever moved you to do it this week and whatever moved us to meet today." He said, "Chris, today is my father's birthday." was like, he says, it's his first birthday in heaven, but today is his birthday, and this is the greatest present that anybody could have gave us. So I knew at that moment, that was, as I was saying, Dave, that was my confirmation for me. That was, God is the be-all, end-all, beginning and the end. He is this creator. He is the one that guides us. He is the one that sees us through. He is the one that will carry us. I used to love that little, if you've ever seen that little footprints passage, you know, when you're walking in the sand and, you know, there's two sets, but then you look down and there's one and you're questioning God, why'd you leave? And it wasn't needed until I left you. It was, I was carrying you. So I really love that one. But yeah, when he told me that, we broke down. It was three grown men crying in Chick-fil-A. But that was really the deal sealer for me. Also, I always, like I said, I would tell Albert about signs that I had. Well, there was something that you said that correlated to my life 5 years ago. There was something that we did here that made sense for me last month that I was having these issues. You know, it was funny. I mean, I'm not proud of it, but I told him this building used to be a VFW. It was a hall. My sister had her sweet 16 here, and now here I am coming to church every Sunday and Wednesday. When we were ripping and running and doing our thing in the streets and, you know, breaking every law we could, and if you're old enough to remember payphones and using payphones, there used to be a payphone in the corner of the parking lot on that telephone pole. So if you carried a pager around, you know, when we would get paged to go certain places to do certain things, we would use that payphone to make deals and do things like that. But now here I am praising God and the same parking lot, the same building where I used to do some things that I'm not proud of. So I just really wanted to touch base with y'all and let y'all in on who I am and be as open and honest as I can be. I want to be as God will allow me to be up here. You know, everybody's asked me, was I nervous to do it? Was I nervous? Was I scared? No. I've been saying that it was like the roller coaster. I was really excited. You know, you get that little, that first climb of the roller coaster. I'm still climbing. I know y'all don't like to hear it, Lori, Cece. You know, I always like to say how new of a Christian I am. You know, it's been 3.5 years, but I still feel like it's been the first day. That's how much God has shown me something every day. Every Tuesday, I learn another verse. You know, I learn another scripture. You know, there's a lot of wisdom in this room, and I appreciate all of you for it. It's funny, when I first got to the booth, you know, Albert came to me one day. I was here about a year's time. And he says, we got a spot. I think you'll fit right in. Because we used to talk about music a lot. He goes, let's put you in here and get you with Lori. And we'll get you with the net. And you'll learn how to run some of the stuff in there. So in befriending Lori, I called out Randy and Candy. And I tell Lori, I says, I think I know them. It's funny. I said, I swear she looks, Candy that is, I said, she looks just like somebody I know from my past. And 2 weeks ago it was confirmed. We were just having the most randomest conversation, and Randy says, he brings up Candy's, one of her jobs from a long time ago. We used to work, it was my first job I ever had. I worked at this Christian warehouse, random, you know. I wasn't a Christian then, but hey, it was a paycheck for me. And she was my boss, you know. And he's like, yeah, she worked there. I was like, oh my God. So I had to tell Lord, I was like, that what I thought was true. So it's just funny how the whole full circle, but doing it in the right way and doing it his way, put you in the right spot, put you where you're supposed to be, put you around the people you're supposed to be around, learning and growing and loving and sharing and doing the Lord's work, and there's a lot of Lord's work being done in this building for everybody that does and has a hand in all of that, for all of you that sit in these seats, for all of you that come every Wednesday, Sunday, watch online. I am thankful for all of y'all. I will say that, so thank you very much. It's just been a blessing to be a part of this and grow and love every minute of it. So I thank you a lot. And there's just, I wish I had more words. I wish I could say more and really truly let y'all know what y'all mean to me and what God means to me now. Because it's definitely a blessing. We all know that. We're all believers. So we're all called to do that work and spread that love and spread that joy and be those fishermen to show everybody else the way. I love doing it with y'all, every one of y'all. So thank you very much. I was really looking forward to today. Everybody thought I'd be too nervous, but I was pretty excited, and I really loved the opportunity that I was given. So thank you, Albert, if you're watching. I love you, brother. You know. So, but I won't keep you guys anymore. We'll close in prayer. But Father God, I just want to come to you this evening and give you thanks. Thank you for every opportunity, for every blessing, for every trial, for the grace that you show us and the mercy that you have on us every day of our lives. Just we ask that you continue to lead us by your light, Lord. Guide our steps, and as I like to say, guide our minds, guide our thoughts, guide our prayers and our actions. In your image we are made, in your light we walk, and in your name we pray. Amen. Thank you.